Thank you. The next item of business is topical questions. As ever, short and concise questions and responses are appreciated. And at question number one, I call Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether it's appropriate for the Chief Executive of Circularity Scotland to be paid a reported annual salary of £300,000.
Minister Lorna Slater.
Circularity Scotland is a not-for-profit company delivered and funded by industry in line with the polluter pays principle. This structure is based on successful schemes seen elsewhere in Europe and was approved by the Scottish Parliament in 2020. Circularity Scotland is therefore separate from government, and we have no role in the recruitment of staff or their pay levels. Decisions on pay are made by the Circularity Scotland Board, which is made up of members who range with a range of experience from across a range of sectors, which is appropriate for a private company that is delivering an industry-led scheme.
Colin Smith.
The Minister said the scheme is business-led, but let's be clear, it's being big business-led at the moment. Only big business can become individual members of Circularity Scotland, and only big business, it would appear, can get contracts such as Biffa for collecting bottles. Let's also be clear, it was the Minister who approved Circularity Scotland, not businesses, but the Minister who made that decision. So could I ask the Minister, was she aware of the proposed likely wage structure for the company's senior executive when she appointed Circularity Scotland as the scheme administrator? If not, when did she become aware of the plan to pay such excessive salaries? And has she at any time expressed concern about those salaries? Because it does seem this monopoly has a licence from the Minister to print money, not for the benefit of producers, but for the benefit of their own bosses.
Minister.
Circularity Scotland is a private, not-for-profit company, and it would be inappropriate for ministers to interfere with or comment on the matters of a... It's a private
company. Thank you.
Company.
We'll hear the minister.
Members of Circularity Scotland do include the Scottish Grocers' Federation, the Scottish Beer and Pub Association, the Society of Independent Brewers, the National Federation of Retail Newsagents, and the Association of Convenience Stores. These are the bodies that make up Circularity Scotland, and small businesses are powerfully represented.
Colin Smith.
I have to say the Minister needs to learn to answer the questions that she's asked. I asked the Minister, was she aware of these wage structures when she appointed Circularity Scotland as the administrator? When did she become aware, and has she at any time expressed concern? Given the importance of ensuring value for money for small producers, are deeply worried about the cost of this scheme. Surely the Minister should have asked for this information before she made that decision, because the regulations are very clear that this Parliament agreed. Applications for approval as a scheme administrator must be made to Scottish ministers and must include any information requested by Scottish ministers. So why was that information not requested? And given that she now knows what those excessive eye-watering salaries are, how does she expect small producers to sign up for a scheme when they're being so clearly ripped off and part of their fees are being used for the excessive salaries of bosses who are using Scotland as a stepping stone for their wider aim of running deposit return schemes right across the UK?
Minister.
Circularity Scotland's application to become scheme administrator was approved on the 21st of March 2021. Any other organisation can also apply to be scheme administrator, provided that they can meet the requirements as set out in the DRS regulations. The DRS regulations were passed by this Parliament, and CSL was an applicant who met those regulations. Producers and small retailers have been an important part of designing and putting in place the Scotland's deposit return scheme, and Circularity Scotland has indeed been working very closely with these businesses, including improving cash flow from day one and having the highest return handling fees for manual return points in the world.
Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, what's clear from the failure once again of the Minister to answer straightforward questions is this, that Circularity Scotland Limited is a creature entirely, entirely out of control. It's deciding its own policies, it's deciding its own salaries, and it will decimate small businesses throughout Scotland, whether they be shops, pubs, clubs, brewers, distillers, or recycling companies. Can I ask the Minister this? Have you not, on behalf of the Scottish Government, in creating Circularity Scotland Limited, created a monster, a modern-day 21st century Frankenstein entirely out of control?
Minister.
Circularity Scotland has been created by industry to support Scottish businesses to comply with the regulations passed by this Parliament. The approach of an industry-led and industry-paid-for scheme was supported by Scottish Labour and the Conservatives and is the same as schemes around the world. We are not reinventing the wheel here. Scotland's scheme is in line with successful schemes around the world.
Stephen Kerr.
Minister can't be serious. I mean, it's an insult to this Parliament that she comes here, is asked questions, and then reads a scripted answer, whether it's relevant to the question that's been asked or not. Is she seriously saying that this not-for-profit that she has facilitated the creation of has got nothing to do with her, that they can do what they like? The people of Scotland will have formed their own views on these monstrous salary numbers, and they'll also be forming a view of the incompetence of this minister, who is patently not fit for purpose.
Minister.
I didn't hear a question in there, but the significant progress has been made towards Scotland's deposit return scheme as we work towards our go-live date in August of this year.
Katie Clark.
The Scottish Government have confirmed that Circularity Scotland is to be exempt from the Freedom of Information Act. Does the Minister agree that freedom of information should be extended to cover all providers of public services, including private firms which provide public services, such as Circularity Scotland?
Minister.
Circularity Scotland is indeed a private company, a private not-for-profit company, and it is not qualify for freedom of information because it is not providing a public service as described by the member. Therefore, as a private company, it is not subject to freedom of information requests.
Thank you. And Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister has been dragged into this chamber week after week because of the secrecy in which is shrouded the Scottish Government-led company. It took a leaked document for us to find out the extraordinary salaries that are getting paid by CSL, because we cannot find anything out about CSL because the Scottish Government won't allow us to FOI them any time they don't want an answer to a question. Bonus Slater has made CSL a private company, so she doesn't have to be held accountable and admit how badly this scheme is being rolled out. Isn't about time you lifted the secrecy, the shroud of secrecy, and allows the Parliament, we parliamentarians, to actually understand what is really going on with this DRS scheme?
Minister.
I've said it before, but I'm happy to repeat it over and over again. Scotland's deposit return scheme is being delivered and funded by industry, an approach that was supported by Scottish Labour and the Scottish Conservatives. And that includes the creation of an industry-led scheme administrator. Many of the questions that are being answered in this chamber could be answered by a simple Google, because CSL has an excellent website. And I would encourage members to look at that if they are unsure of who is the membership makeup of CSL and who their board members are.
Thank you. Can we just resist any temptation to speak over ministers when they are responding? I call Rachel Hamilton at question number two.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Scottish Fishermen's Federation recent warnings about the potential impact of highly protected marine areas on the fishing industry.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, I should like to begin by acknowledging that this is an issue which I expect shall generate interest among many stakeholders. Like a lot of matters in my environment and land reform portfolio, there are a spectrum of views and often polarised views on either end of that spectrum. But as I have tried to handle other similar matters, I'd like to give a cast iron assurance that the process will engage very broadly and very deeply, including with all those affected by the policy, because that's something that I believe very strongly in. However, I can't answer this question without referencing yesterday's IPCC report, which has been called a survival guide for humanity and makes the urgency of taking action on the climate and nature emergencies absolutely plain. We are right at the very early stages of developing highly protected marine areas. Our consultation is ongoing. It's seeking views on what they should look like, how they should be selected, and how they should be implemented. But I'll close just by saying that the fishing communities should be reassured that their views will be heard as part of the consultation, and that the socio-economic factors affecting the resilience of marine industries, including fishers and the coastal communities, will be taken into account.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Last night, Scotland's Finance Secretary echoed the words of Elspeth MacDonald from SFF, saying that these are unevidenced proposals which have been hijacked by the Greens and will push the fishing industry into the red. The SNP Health Secretary views differ and believes the Greens are right. Which of the two leading candidates to become Scotland's First Minister does the Environment Minister agree with? The candidate who quotes industry experts or the candidate who panders to Green Party ideology?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am not really clear on the relevance of the question posed to the issue of highly protected marine areas, and I would encourage Rachel Hamilton to focus on the issue at hand, something which is likely to be much more important to coastal and fishing communities than perhaps the SNP leadership contest and the exchanges of candidates within that. My position is exceptionally clear that we are in the teeth of a climate and nature crisis. The opportunity, the window for us to take action commensurate with that challenge is narrowing. We must be bold. HPMAs are a bold proposal, but on the same token, I am equally clear that everyone who will be affected by this policy will be very deeply and widely consulted as we develop it.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mary McCallum's absolutely right. The SNP are indeed in crisis. Councillor Norman MacDonald said that it is clear that Edinburgh-based government ministers have no understanding of the devastating consequences these disgraceful proposals will have on the economy and the community of the Outer Hebrides. The chairwoman of Tyree Community Development Trust said the island was perilously close to being non-viable, with a local fisherman adding, "If this is landed on top of us, we would be wiped out overnight with one stroke of the pen on a chart." Furthermore, SFF have been clear that these proposals, which would decimate our vital industry, are entirely unevidenced. So, Presiding Officer, I want to ask the Minister, will the Government listen? Will they commit to taking an evidence approach to HPMAs? Or are we going to see a repeat of the Clyde Cod Box debacle on a national scale, which was the demand of the Green Party for their support for independence at the expense of fragile rural communities, their livelihoods and their lives?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm quite sure my colleague Lorna Slater won't mind me speaking for her when I say the Green Party's support for independence predates some of the issues that Rachel Hamilton has raised there, but you know, I would hope it has been demonstrably clear from my responses that consultation is at the core of how we are developing this proposal. It's why I, on the 12th of December, published a consultation paper, a policy framework, site selection guidelines, a partial islands and communities impact assessment, a partial business and regulatory impact assessment, and initial sustainability appraisals. It's also why we have a significant stakeholder engagement programme, starting now with the consultation, which includes actually taking some stakeholders through the process of responding to the consultation, and I can commit to that continuing right through the development of this policy.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Evidence is clear, not least from the no-take zone in Lamlash Bay, that protected areas benefit both fishers and fish, and that 1 hectare of protected ocean in which fishing is not permitted produces at least 5 times the quantity of fish as an equivalent unprotected hectare, fish that can swim into unprotected areas to be caught. So, in discussions with the fishing industry, will the Minister continue to emphasise that highly protected areas ultimately serve the interests of fishers themselves, as well as helping to restore marine biodiversity?
Minister.
Yes, I think Ken Gibson is absolutely right. One of the elements right at the heart of our proposals are plans to do more, to do exactly what he says, to protect essential fish habitats. We believe that a properly designed network of HPMAs will provide benefits to fishers, and that the best way of realising those benefits is to work with fishers when designing the proposals. So we're committed to a participatory process, some of which I've set out, which listens to the views of fishers, which helps make our coastal communities more resilient, and which absolutely recognises that the sustainability and the health of our seas are good for fishers and for coastal communities, as well as to the imperative of tackling climate change.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of the devastating consequences of those proposals and how they will impact on rural and island communities. Banning sustainable fishing and marine activity that has safeguarded our waters and their features for generations is nonsensical. The Harris Development Trust summed up the views of many island communities when they said, "It is sheer arrogance for desk-bound experts to suggest that we are not looking after our environment or protecting our stocks. The whole basis of the HPMA is that locals are clearly not doing what they should and need to be told how to look after it. You take no cognizance of the evidence that is available of sustainable fisheries and local voluntary measures put in place before marching in and wiping out our communities. Will the Minister therefore listen to our communities and support their work in protecting their marine environment rather than taking a top-down approach?"
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm only sorry that members aren't listening to what I've said, and if they're not going to take it from me, perhaps they will look at the multitude of papers that I published in December and the work that I'm currently doing and officials in Marine Scotland are doing to talk stakeholders through them and to help them submit their views to this consultation. There is no part of this which I do not want the views of stakeholders to be embedded within. But just on the point about, you know, the reason that we have to do this, I mentioned the IPCC. It's absolutely clear we have that narrowing window. But equally, the Scottish Marine Assessment, it tells us that we have much more to do in achieving good environmental status and that more needs to be done to protect ecosystems and benthic habitats, including from damage by fishing. So all of that underpins the policy here, but it will absolutely be developed hand in hand with stakeholders.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased the Minister is prepared to listen, but she'll be aware of a column piece by her Green Party colleague which outraged communities from Shetland to Tyree and our fishing fleet who know our seas well. The 10% figure for HPMAs in the Bute House Agreement seems concocted. Can the Minister explain the scientific basis for this figure and consider evidence-gathering pilot projects?
Minister.
There's a lot of useful points in that. I've spoken about the scientific underpinning of this. I've spoken about the IPCC report. There can be no clearer depiction of the crisis in which the whole world finds itself and the very specific need for us to up our efforts. I also mentioned the marine assessment. And on the point about the timeline and the 10%, I would draw members' attention to the fact that the EU biodiversity strategy for 2030, it's requiring member states to step up their conservation efforts to protect 30% of both Europe's land and sea by 2030, of which 10% will have to be strictly protected. So Scotland is not out of step here whatsoever.
Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear the Minister outline the benefits of HPMAs. We've heard about Lamlash Bay and Arran. England's Lundy Island no-take zone shows evidence of increased tourism spend and larger lobsters, which benefit the local shellfish fishery. But there's evidence and learning to be gained from more established no-take zones. So can I ask the Minister if the Scottish Government is in communication with other territories such as California, New Zealand and Norway to learn how their fisheries and coastal economies have benefited from no-take zones?
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Ms Burgess is absolutely correct. Scientific studies tell us that we can expect fish stocks to increase in HPMAs. Providing spillover benefits for fishers. And of course, a good example of this is evidence from Southern California of the benefits from marine protected areas for the spiny lobster fishery. The experience of New Zealand and Australia have helped to inspire our vision that recreational users will visit coastal HPMAs for their enjoyment and appreciation, bringing, of course, economic benefits to the communities as they do so. And I should be very happy to provide Ms Burgess with the published evidence on this that has informed our position.
Finlay Carson.
With little available research, can the Minister explain why fish habitats have already been listed as a priority for site designation when the report commissioned on this subject remains unpublished and in draft form? And will the Minister also acknowledge that current research work is not sufficiently far advanced or robust to be reliable to form policies which could see the lights go off in our coastal communities?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm sorry, I'm not even sure where to begin with that question. There's a lot of vagaries and it makes it difficult to respond with the specificity that I would want to. I mean, I would suggest to Finlay Carson that firstly, we're at the very early stages and we are taking the opportunity to ask people
what they think should form the basis of the HPMAs. And there's a number of things that we've suggested, blue carbon being one of them, essential fish habitats, strengthening the Scottish MPA network, protecting from storms, research and education, enjoyment and appreciation, and other important ecosystems. To the extent that Mr. Carson has views on which of these should be prioritised, I would encourage him to fill in the consultation. And as I've said in all the responses today, I want to be absolutely clear that we will take all of the responses into account. And I absolutely agree that fishers and our coastal communities have a really strong stake in this and need to be involved.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.